Forget everything you thought you knew about wind farms. We're about to dive deep into the world of floating offshore wind, where we'll witness giant turbines gracefully swaying on the waves, harnessing the power of the wind located far out at sea to generate clean energy that has the potential to revolutionize the way that we think about sustainable power. In this video, we'll take an exhilarating ride through the floating offshore wind industry, from the awe-inspiring engineering that keeps these colossal structures afloat to the innovative designs that could shape the future of wind energy. I'm Rosie Barnes, an engineer with 20 years experience developing clean energy technologies. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Today we're talking floating offshore wind, and let's just be upfront that it is currently much more expensive than fixed bottom offshore wind, and that in turn is much more expensive than onshore wind. So why even bother? As I explained in more detail in my previous video about offshore wind, the wind resources at sea are just much better than they are on land. There are higher wind speeds because on the ocean there are no trees, hills, or buildings to slow down winds close to the ground, and winds tend to be more consistent. In combination, that adds up to significantly increased energy output for offshore wind compared to onshore. And then, perhaps counterintuitively, offshore wind farms can actually often be located closer to coastal cities than onshore wind can, reducing the need for expensive and not always popular overland transmission infrastructure. But these advantages come at a financial cost compared to onshore wind. Now, moving on to floating offshore, it has those same advantages and cost penalty, only more so. Fixed bottom offshore wind is only suitable in waters up to around 60 meters deep, whereas floating offshore can go much deeper. And that opens up many more options that might have better wind speed and also areas that have no shallow waters suitable for fixed bottom offshore. Another potential advantage is that wind farms can be located far from shore. And that means that people who don't like how wind turbines look or sound don't have to look at or hear them. And there are some other potential advantages of floating wind that we'll get to in a minute. But before we go any further, let's talk about something important. Energy technology is often subjected to sensational or misleading reporting. The media tends to be either overly optimistic, as if these technologies will solve all our energy issues, or excessively critical, highlighting flaws without context. This is why I wanted to share a tool that I've been using to help cut through the noise. Ground News, who are the sponsors of today's video.
Ground News is an app and website that gathers related articles from sources worldwide and provides context on each source's political leanings, reliability, and ownership, allowing users to compare coverage and critically evaluate news.
Take a look at this story on the recent blade failure at a Nantucket offshore wind farm. Ground News has coverage by 42 sources, 39% lean left, 30% lean right. If you scroll down, you can see every article about this topic and compare headlines. Left-leaning and centrist sources used passive phrasing like washed ashore to describe how fiberglass ended up on beaches. In contrast, right-leaning sources use dramatic active language like spews debris and scatters fiberglass shards to describe the same events. Another great feature of Ground News is the blind spot feed, which highlights news stories that are disproportionately covered by one side of the political spectrum. This feature can help you stay informed about important topics that might otherwise go unnoticed if all your preferred sources all lean to one side. For example, there's a story about wind and solar energy having overtaken fossil fueled electricity in Europe, which has less than 25% right-wing coverage. I can't recommend enough that you subscribe to Ground News and support an independent platform working to make current events easier to understand. This is a brand that I wanted to work with and to inform you guys about. You can save 40% on the same unlimited access Vantage plan I use by using my exclusive QR code or heading to ground.news/Rosie. Now, let's get back to how on earth you can even make a huge heavy wind turbine float. A regular wind turbine is not exactly made to float with its high center of gravity. The stability of a floating wind turbine is crucial. It needs to stay upright with a rotor facing the wind directly to capture wind energy effectively. That means controlling six types of motion: surge, sway, and heave displacements, plus roll, pitch, and yaw rotations. So, how do we make those towering structures stay upright out at sea? Well, engineers have come up with some ingenious solutions, mostly borrowing from designs used in the offshore oil and gas industry and other marine applications. Floating foundations should withstand wind turbine forces and minimize pitch motions for optimal efficiency. Three stabilization methods exist. One, gravity stabilized. This method makes a platform stable by lowering its center of gravity. Think of it like a toy with a heavy bottom that always stays upright. Second is water plane stabilized. This technique increases stability by making the base of the platform wide and flat. Think of how much easier it is to capsize a canoe compared to a catamaran. The wide base of the catamaran spreads out over the water, making it more stable and less likely to tip over when waves or wind push against it. Third is more stabilized. This approach uses multiple strong anchors and cables attached to the seabed to keep the platform in place. Imagine a tent held steady with several ropes and stakes all around it. If one rope gets loose, the others still hold the tent securely. Similarly, multiple mooring lines keep the floating platform stable in the water. There is not yet anything close to an industry standard. Last count, there are over 40 different configurations of float and mooring type in various stages of development. Selection is usually on a case-by-case basis, taking into consideration factors like depth and seabed type. Now let's take a look at how these principles are being used in floating structures that we see in the water today. To make the turbine float, a simple option is a barge or buoyant substructure. It's like a giant raft that supports the turbine using air or lightweight materials to stay afloat. It's a simple design that works best in calmer waters. FloatGen's 2-megawatt demonstrator turbine, Francis First, uses a floating barge. For rougher seas, we have the semi-submersible platform. This one's got a floating platform with underwater pontoons or columns that keep it stable, even in choppy conditions. This design is borrowed from the offshore oil and gas industry, where it's been used for decades to support drilling rigs and other structures. The 5 floating wind turbines in the Kincardine wind farm off the coast of Scotland use this type of substructure. Then there's the tension leg platform. Imagine a giant water balloon anchored to the seabed with taut cables. That's essentially how a tension leg platform works, providing excellent stability in deep waters. This design also has its roots in the oil and gas industry, where it's been used for floating production platforms. Last year, 3 8.4 megawatt turbines were installed on TLP floaters in 100 meter deep waters off the coast of France. And finally, we have the spar buoy. This is a long cylindrical structure that floats upright like a giant buoy. Its weight is evenly distributed, making it incredibly stable, even in the deepest waters. Spar buoys were originally used to moor naval vessels, but have been adapted for use with floating wind turbines due to their excellent stability characteristics. This is probably the most common that we are seeing in floating wind farms currently. Highwind Scotland and Highwind Tampen both use spar buoy structures. In addition to these traditional types of substructure, another possibility is to integrate active control systems into floating wind turbines to enhance stability. Sensors, actuators, and control algorithms enable real-time monitoring and adjustment of the turbine's behavior. This can minimize structural loads, optimize power generation as the turbine is always facing exactly into the wind, instead of dipping and turning a little bit every time there's a gust or a wave. All of that sounds complicated, right? Compared to simply whacking a wind turbine tower into the seafloor? Yes, floating wind is complicated. And complexity usually means two things: higher costs and lower reliability. And so far, floating offshore wind is both of those. Floating wind currently costs much more than fixed bottom offshore, usually in the range of 2 to 4 times more expensive. To give an example, the next UK auction for renewable energy has maximum prices set to £73 for fixed bottom offshore wind and £176 for floating. And to illustrate reliability of floating offshore wind, the Highwind Scotland project, the world's first commercial scale floating offshore wind farm, it is currently undergoing heavy maintenance with its 5 turbines taken offline for 3 to 4 months over the northern summer, and the turbines were towed back to Norway to perform the work. This maintenance is necessary due to operational data indicating the need for extensive repairs and exchange of components, including defective bearings. But we're still really early days for floating offshore wind. Both cost and reliability tend to improve as technologies mature. Floating offshore is still very young, and it's moving in the right direction on both of these measures. Projects so far have been small, first of a kind, so costs are going to reduce naturally as we develop more and larger projects. Other opportunities to reduce cost will involve reducing materials. Floating offshore should eventually be able to use less steel than fixed bottom. We would also expect to see a reduction in complexity of designs and improvements in manufacturing. Also, better reliability and less onerous maintenance requirements as we learn more about the specific operating environment. The challenges facing floating offshore wind are substantial, but the potential rewards are too great to ignore. While it's true that we're still in the early days of floating offshore wind, with just a handful of wind farms installed today, the industry is rapidly evolving. Floating wind got started back in 2007 when the world's first floating wind turbine, the 80 kilowatt Blue H prototype, was installed off the coast of Italy. Fast forward to 2023 and we get to Highwind Tampen, which is currently the world's largest floating wind farm. It's located off the coast of Norway and it powers nearby oil and gas platforms with its 11 turbines using floating concrete substructures in waters 260 to 300 meters deep. It produces 88 megawatts of electricity, which covers about 35% of the annual electricity of the platforms that it supplies. all up today, there's a little over 200 megawatts of floating offshore wind commissioned in the first 16 years of the industry. That's about 0.02% of the world's wind energy. Not very impressive, right? Well, under construction are projects that will quadruple the amount installed, and additionally over 200 gigawatts of potential projects have been announced. And that is kind of impressive. To put that in context, that's about 20% of today's global wind power. If they all went ahead, and let's be real, they won't, but something like 60 gigawatts are reasonably likely. That is a tremendous amount of projects for a technology that is still very young, with many design kinks remaining to be worked out. Kind of sounds like a big risk, doesn't it? Despite the infancy of offshore wind technology and its complexities, developers are betting big on its potential. Let's look at some of the countries with floating wind projects planned and why they think it's worth the risk. Europe has been the hub for floating offshore wind, with Norway leading the charge, leveraging its offshore expertise from oil and gas. This trend continues with Norway's Utsira Nord zone, poised to accommodate 1.5 gigawatts of floating wind across three projects. France has several smaller projects under construction, and the UK leads with ambitious plans for 13 gigawatts of floating wind. And there are several other European countries getting in on the action too. Countries with limited clean energy options are also exploring floating wind. Japan, with its extensive coastline and vast exclusive economic zone, EEZ, sees offshore wind as vital for its energy transition and has plans to use this industry to reinvigorate local manufacturing by mass producing floating platforms. They're currently tentatively dipping a toe into their floating wind potential with just one small 16.8 megawatt project currently in construction for completion hopefully in 2026. South Korea is another country with limited domestic renewable energy resources, and they're not just dipping a toe, but instead diving straight in with several projects of around 1 gigawatt currently in planning, and the first to begin construction is expected to be the 504 megawatt stage 1 of Grey Whale 3 wind farm in late 24. China, a renewable technology manufacturing giant, is also entering the floating wind arena, aiming to drive down costs and accelerate global adoption, similar to what they've already done for solar panels and lithium-ion batteries. The US, despite challenges with fixed-bottom installations, is moving ahead with floating wind efforts, recognizing its vast deepwater potential in critical markets like California, the Gulf of Maine, and the Gulf of Mexico. And the US federal government have launched the floating offshore wind energy shot to try to take out about 3/4 of the cost of floating wind by 2035 to $45 per megawatt hour. And even here in Australia, where we don't have a single fixed bottom offshore wind farm yet, we're forging ahead with floating wind projects being planned in a couple of regions that don't suit fixed bottom. So far, all of the floating wind farms have just stuck a standard offshore wind turbine onto a floating substructure and called it a day. But there are other design options emerging too. There are vertical axis wind turbines that can locate the generator at the bottom and so get a lower center of gravity. And there are any number of changes to tower configurations to make installation easier or make them easier to float. There are multi-rotor designs that can get more power from each electrical connection without needing to build massive rotors and hopefully avoiding some of the problems that come along with massive turbines. With the right design, there is potential for floating wind to solve several of the big challenges of fixed bottom offshore wind, like needing massive amounts of steel for substructures and challenges related to assembling, installing, maintaining massive turbines offshore. It's not outside the realms of possibility that floating wind could end up being the simpler, cheaper technology for offshore wind in any depth of water someday in the future. And like I said, there are currently more than 40 floating wind concepts currently under development trying to do just that. The reason that there are so many is that floating wind is such a different design problem with different design constraints than what led to the three-blade rotor stuck on a stick that totally dominates the environment that it evolved in. Onshore wind. For floating wind, the floating structure and mooring is as important as the rotor. Maintenance is massively more expensive and the operating environment is so much more harsh. I think that if we were starting from scratch, if there was no onshore wind and we went straight to floating, there is no way that we would end up with that same standard design that we see onshore. But we aren't starting from scratch. Legacy wind turbine manufacturers have decades of experience at making their turbines. They have been through all the little unexpected ways that these designs failed, and they've had times to fix them to refine their designs over dozens of iterations. In contrast, a brand new design like the vertical axis C12 or the multi-rotor wind catching have brand new aerodynamics to learn about, totally new structural requirements to satisfy, etc., etc. All of the surprising whales that these designs can fail lie ahead of them. And if they experience those failures while while floating 100 kilometres out to sea, they might not have the resources to refine their designs based on those learnings. So even if these concepts are superior to simply placing a standard wind turbine on a floating platform, that doesn't guarantee their success. I do hope that we see some of the 40 exciting new concepts succeed, because it's a fascinating engineering challenge to make something totally new work, and there's nothing I love more than a good engineering challenge. We're still too early in floating wind's journey to be able to say how the technology is going to pan out, but there are disruptive elements to the technology. Yes, in terms of cost, it currently underperforms compared to mainstream electricity generation technologies, and for now, it is mostly appealing in quite niche markets. Likely a big deal for countries who don't have a lot of other options for energy security, and many think that's as far as it will go, with DNV, for example, projecting that floating offshore wind will only make up 6% of the future world's wind energy. That's still 264 gigawatts, about 1,000 times more floating offshore than we have installed today, and actually not that far off the world's total nuclear capacity at about 380 gigawatts. So that's actually pretty big, but there is a chance for it to make a much bigger contribution. Underperformance in mainstream markets and appeal to niche markets are two of the hallmarks of a disruptive innovation, according to Clayton Christensen's classic book, The Innovator's Dilemma. The third is rapid improvement. That's a tick. We're learning fast in this technology. And fourth is potential for disrupting business models. There is definitely a possibility for floating wind to cut some of fixed bottom offshore wind's grass if it lives up to its potential for lower materials costs and cheaper and simpler installation and maintenance. And I can imagine new applications that floating wind could open up that don't exist today for traditional wind. Could we see floating wind farms powering refueling stations on major shipping routes, for example, either to recharge batteries or creating hydrogen or derivatives that thereby disrupt the shipping fuel industry also? For that one, we'll have to wait and see. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team, whose valuable support keeps this channel going. Thanks to Ground News for supporting this video, and don't forget to sign up at ground.news/Rosie to get 40% off. And thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.